Okay, so before we begin, I just want to actually introduce you to the panel that we've got for this evening. We've got, as far as the main panel goes, there's myself, and I'm going to be focused on the nutrition side, etc. We've got Raymond Orkison, who actually had a power failure just before this actual webinar started, but he'll be joining us very shortly. And he's a running coach. He was the captain of the Betterby Athletics Club, and he runs a coaching site called runethics.com, and he's a silver medalist at Comrades. We've got Cuan Walker as well, who's online, and Cuan, many people know him as the SABC commentator. He's got a vast knowledge of as far as running is concerned. He spends a lot of time in Kenya with some of the world's elite runners. And he also happens to manage quite a few of the elite Mr. Price Sport, which are the max elite athletes. As far as athletes go, we've got Prodigal Kumalo, who's with Cuan. He's the city-to-city marathon champ. He has got a 5-hour 43 Comrades marathon. He'll be there as well to answer some questions. And Shaun Meiklejohn hopefully will also be joining us. He's obviously 1995 Comrades marathon winner. And he just goes to show that he's, the results he's even putting out now at his age is incredible. He's really a top vet runner with a wealth of experience and might be able to answer quite a few of your questions as well. Okay, so I'm going to actually start with a small presentation on nutrition. I'm not here to sell products by any means. I'm here to talk about natural nutrition, and I think that's very critical to everybody. Hopefully most of you have got your nutrition down packed for the day of the race. And we can chat about it a little bit later if you don't. So what I want to discuss firstly is let's have a look at a nutrition strategy. And at the moment, you're busy tapering towards Comrade. You're lowering your volume and probably a little bit of the intensity at the same time. And one of the biggest things you can actually focus on currently is actually nutrition before the event and leading up to the event. Obviously, as you get closer to the event, what you're going to do the hours leading up to the actual race day and on race day. So what I look at is race week nutrition. In other words, the weeks leading up to the race, 2 days prior to the race, in my mind, are very, very critical for any endurance event. The day before is extremely critical, and then obviously race day is just as critical. One of the things that I always like to tell people, and I think this is quite important to note, is that a nutrition program for any endurance event should be well thought out, tested, and documented for the big day. In other words, plan your nutrition very carefully for any event and make sure that you stick to it on the day. If you haven't practiced it in training, well, you need to practice it now. There's no point in arriving at an endurance event in top physical condition only to succumb to the forgotten ills of digestive issues such as cramping, nausea, lack of energy, and fatigue. And I can tell you from personal experience and managing quite a few of the athletes from a nutrition point of view, Comrades is a very long, hard race, and it does that to your system. I mean, if you haven't got it planned, it can cause havoc. Okay, so the weeks before Comrades is very critical in terms of nutrition. Training time is over. You're in complete taper, which I mentioned earlier. You've got to maximize, obviously, rest and recovery. There's only one thing that you can really focus on, and that's nutrition. What to avoid in the weeks leading up to Comrades? I put there the week, but actually the weeks leading up to Comrades. Things like refined carbohydrates, which are basically very simple carbs with a lot of processed sugars. Processed foods, I put there as instant microwave or quick meals such as takeouts. Deep fried foods, so KFC is definitely out. Sugar-laden foods, meaning sweets, etc. This entire presentation will be made available to you so you can have a look through it, but it's very important to try and eliminate anything that would impact your body negatively. There are some people who obviously look at a high-fat diet is a low-carb diet. I'm actually one of those people. So you might, for those kind of people, obviously you still want to look at taking in some of your trans fats. I actually avoid the trans fats, but I stick to more of the unsaturated kind of fats. But it's something that a lot of people on the high-fat diets actually tend to still stick with. And if that is the case, then there's no problem at all. Foods that are very high in fiber can cause bowel discomfort as well. So just make sure you try and avoid that, especially in the week leading up to the event. Also, one of the things that can play a very critical role is a substance like caffeine. And one of the things, if you want to actually make caffeine work for you, one of the biggest things you can do is to actually try and become a little bit caffeine intolerant. In other words, try and reduce the amount of caffeine intake and become very intolerant to caffeine, because if you're very tolerant to caffeine, it doesn't really make a difference on race day. And I'll explain that a little bit later. Maybe in a Q&A session I can explain to you how caffeine actually works. But what should you focus on eating? And this is one of the things that are one of the charts that I always say. Complex carbohydrates, I've mentioned a few. Quinoa, amaranth, oats, sweet potatoes, etc. are very good for you. Easily digestible and lighter proteins, such as soya, fish, chicken, eggs. And then healthy fats. Flaxseed, coconut oil is, to me, one of the big oils that's it's a big favorite out there. Avocado, salmon, things like nuts and seeds, almonds, cashews, walnuts are very good for you. Chia seeds, sunflower and sesame, like tahini sauce and those kinds of seeds are actually quite good. And they do play a benefit as far as energy levels go. Remember, when you're eating here towards Comrades, one of the biggest things that you need to worry about is not just your health. You need to get to race day with a strong immune system. A lot of people, when they start to pick up mileage, actually feel ill. And that can lead to, you know, it leads to problems. You don't want to land up being ill. And a lot of people have landed up in courses of antibiotics just before Comrades. And really it's due to probably weak nutrition, heavy mileage, and obviously a lack of proper rest and recovery. Fruit and vegetables can play a very big role in keeping your immune system up. I would look at around 2 to 3 fruit a day, and probably a higher vegetable count as well. If you can get your carbs from vegetables, that's also very good. Stick to a lot of greens as well. Very good for you. Dairy, I always put a little flag next to dairy, a little red flag. A lot of people enjoy dairy and they love it. However, a lot of people do have allergic reactions to it without even realizing. Lactose intolerance and even sinus issues, etc., post-nasal drips, which can lead to an infection at some stage. If you want to try and keep your post-nasal dry, one of the biggest things that I always recommend is to try and avoid dairy in the weeks leading up to an event. It really does make a difference. I, for one, actually cut out dairy as an experiment a long time ago, and it's quite amazing. In actual fact, my sense of smell was heightened significantly, and one of the things that I did notice is that I had fewer throat infections, and actually, in actual fact, hardly ever. It's made a very big difference. If you are going to want dairy, goat's milk, I always think, is best. I always believe that, and this is just my own personal opinion, cow's milk is for calves, goat's milk is probably better for human beings. Okay, what about hydration? I actually recommend taking, and this is to most of our clients, is around 40 milliliters of per kilogram of body weight of fluid, and I do not mean coffee and green tea, I mean water. Or if you added lemon water to it or any other fruit for that matter. A lot of people think that consuming stimulants still counts as consuming a liquid, and it's not true, because they act as diuretics. Caffeine and green tea act as a diuretic, and what will actually happen is there's more water loss when consuming those. So I actually tell my clients, if you are going to drink a cup of coffee or you're going to drink a cup of green tea, add an extra 2 additional glasses of water for every cup of coffee consumed. I weigh around 66, 67 kilograms. I drink about 3 liters of water a day while I'm training, 3 to 3.2, depending on the extent of training. Definitely without training, at least a minimum of 2.5 up to even 3 liters of water sometimes. Rooibos is okay. It doesn't have caffeine in, so as a tea, that's fine. And I'm sure you guys will have some questions around it. As you get closer to Comrades event, there's the 2 days or the 48 hours before are very critical. One of the things that I always say to people is that you need to ensure that you're eating and hydrating consistently and not skipping meals. This is to keep your energy levels up. This is to make sure that your glycogen levels are topped up. And hydrating yourself, one of the most critical things you can actually do is arrive on race day 100% hydrated. If you only arrive at race day 60 or 70% hydrated, you are going to land up in trouble in an endurance event that's as many hours as, say, Comrades. Avoid things like heavy red meats. Look, it's not for everybody. I'm just generalizing here. But red meat does take a very long time to digest. And I actually have had athletes who have eaten red meat and have had to sit with the discomfort of running with it while it's sitting in their stomach. So just understand that more easily digested proteins probably will go a long way, which are light proteins such as maybe chicken or turkey or fish, etc. The day before an event, you really want to be careful of what you're eating. You really need to stick to the plan. You don't want digestive issues. Those 48 hours before an event are so critical because just taking in the wrong food substance can actually cause a digestive problem. I'll give you an example. One of my pro athletes, top professional athlete, actually at Ironman this year, landed up in a foreign city, okay, and because he doesn't live in Port Elizabeth, he landed up eating at, I think it was one of the Italian restaurants. He landed up having some pasta. You've got to think that these towns are overloaded with clientele, especially during an event, so they need to churn over the clients as quickly as possible. It was mass production of pasta in a pot, which probably wasn't cleaned very often, and what actually happened was it led to severe stomach issues on the day, nausea, vomiting, and he had to pull out in the middle of the race. And something that takes so long to prepare for, the last thing you want to do is get there and you can't race, or you have a miserable race because you've ended up getting ill. If you have a high carbohydrate diet, I would recommend making your lunchtime meal your high carb meal. I wouldn't plan on eating excessive carbohydrates the night before the event. They really don't play much of a role in assisting you. In actual fact, they will impact your sleep more than anything. And one of the things you want to try and get the night before the race is as much sleep as possible. In order to get as much sleep as possible, your digestive system needs to be very well balanced and not over full. I often get athletes overeating the night before an event, and then they'll end up tossing and turning in their beds, not just due to race nerves, but also due to discomfort, and it's not something that you want to experience the night before an event. So I've just put an example there, like eating something very simple, like a vegetable omelette on low GI bread, or scrambled eggs on a toast, or side salad, or chicken, or chicken salad for dinner. Something as light as that is actually very, very useful. It's not going to impact you whatsoever. More importantly is the meal that you're going to actually have on race day. Just a matter of interest, just to make this a little bit more of an interactive session, I'm going to pop a poll quickly to you guys. Just as a matter of interest, how many Comrades Marathon events have you guys participated in? You can answer online, and you can actually share those results with the rest of the attendees that are online at the moment. Okay. The morning of Comrades race is very crucial. I think that one of the most critical things that you've got to understand is, and this has happened to a lot of people, is they say, I can't eat before a race, but it is the most crucial thing to eat before a race. If you do not eat before your race, you're not actually giving your body sufficient fuel to sustain it for quite a number of hours, and you will need to do that. I always recommend eating a meal on race day which will provide stability and give you some of the energy requirements that will be needed later on in the race. A meal should consist of at least around 300 calories or so. I wouldn't make it only a carbohydrate meal. I would make it a combination of carbohydrates, protein, and fat, because protein and fat are obviously more sustainable, and they'll come into play a little bit later on. It also keeps you feeling fuller for longer, so it will keep that hunger at bay. Some examples of meals prior to a race, I've written on the screen there, rolled oats, peanut or almond butter, a half a banana with it, which actually is also excellent as a food source, it's got potassium in, or low GI bread, raw oats or seed loaf with peanut or almond butter, honey, banana, etc. Low GI cereal, recommendations for low GI cereal, for example, could be something like eggs on low GI toast, low GI cereal, for example, could be something like Future Life, Pronutro, at least the whole wheat. And basically we'd be able to see from there. Sorry, I'm just, somebody's actually asked a question. I just wanted to bring it up here and just see if it was relevant to this. Okay, so we've actually got some people. I just wanted to mention, so some of the people that are on here have actually Some have run one Comrades marathon. I've got some people that have run 9, 10, 12 Comrades marathons. So quite interesting to see. Sweet potato is an excellent pre-race food. By the way, when you're cooking potatoes, I always tell people, boil them or steam them or whatever. Do not roast them or bake them, because what actually happens is the sugar content inside a potato concentrates very much. It ends up being a sugar bomb, even worse than glucose. So it will spark you and it will drop you. There's no doubt. When heading off to the race is quite important. Understand that the time period between eating your breakfast and going to the race could be a number of hours. Okay, it's very good to snack on something, not right up until the point that the race starts, because you don't want to start with a very, very full stomach, but you don't want your energy levels to dwindle either. So if you've got 2 hours until the race, to snack on something light, like maybe a half a banana, or a bar, like a food bar or something like that, would actually go down very well. One of the things I always tell people, do not overdrink, because it leads to bladder overload before a race. And based on the fact that you've already got pre-race nerves, I can tell you something now, that you're not going to feel very comfortable. I tend to, before races, hydrate very, just to what my body's used to, so that I will not need to go to the loo, and I do not, when you're running, you're jolting your bladder quite significantly, and the last thing you want to do is actually cause any discomfort. Do not overeat either, because it also leads to digestive discomfort. So if you want to eat something that's much more easy going on the stomach. There is some advocating by some companies to actually consume a gel at the start of the race, because it sparks your blood sugar levels, which is said to sort of top off your glycogen levels and to try and keep those glycogen levels maximized. I've got a very big problem with that, because if you consume a sparking product like that, in order to be able to utilize that blood sugar, you need to perform at a high intensity. If you're not performing at a high intensity, the blood sugar is not really going to be utilized, and it's going to be a blood sugar overload to your system. You've got to understand, you're running Comrades Marathon. You're not running a 10K race or a 5K time trial, whatever it is. You know, if you're doing a shorter distance race, I would say, yes, that's perfect. Pop it in the beginning. Your performance is going to be at a very high level. You're only going to be able to chew up glycogen for energy, because the performance is extremely high. So possibly you would want to consume something to transfer that glycogen as much as possible. But we know glycogen anyway gives you anywhere between 90 to 120 minutes worth of energy, probably around 2,000 calories worth. At Comrades, you're not worried about glucose feeding your system or de-sparking your system. You're running at a controlled pace. You're running at a slower pace than what you would do normally in a marathon or even a half marathon shorter. So unless you're an elite, maybe. But one of the things you need to remember is that your fat store tapping is actually something that's very critical that will come into play when you're running Comrades. Your glycogen is not going to last you forever. The way to spare glycogen is to tap into fat. If you can harness your fat stores while you're running Comrades, you'll have an awesome Comrades. You'll spare your glycogen as much as possible. And fat is a very, very powerful form of energy. I'm going to go into a little bit more detail. One of the other things that a gel does is, if you're not performing at a high intensity and you consume it, you need to also take in a minimum amount of liquid with it, which would be around 280 mL of water. If you don't consume and dilute to that extent, you will end up getting GI distress. I've seen a lot of people at Comrades Marathon feeling nauseous at the 50K mark, dizziness, nausea, running stomach, irritated bowels. That can easily be GI distress due to sugar overload, and it's something you really need to manage while you're busy racing. Endurance fueling is really one of those aspects that many athletes actually get wrong. Many athletes fail to be able to consume proper food consistently throughout an event, which leaves them falling short. There's two rules that I always say you should actually keep in mind. Eat small and eat frequently. If you do that, your energy levels will be balanced over a longer period of time. If you can't eat for the first 21 or 30 kilometers, let's say, and then you start to eat only after that, it's a very, very difficult thing to do, because all of a sudden your digestive system, your bowels haven't consumed any food, and now all of a sudden you're going to give it food, but you've been running with nothing in your stomach. It's a little bit of a shock to the system. At the same time, it takes time for those foods to actually be digested and absorbed. So I would rather eat small amounts. Once you're into an aerobic zone, rather eat small amounts of food, eat it consistently, and you'll find that you have a much more far balanced energy level during the race. Another thing is that I stress is only drink to thirst, because one of the biggest mistakes that athletes actually make is that they try and preempt thirst, and they actually land up drinking to try and prevent their thirst, because they're so worried about dehydration. But let me tell you something, one of the biggest problems at Comrades is actually overhydration. Overhydration has very similar symptoms to dehydration. It can lead to nausea, it can lead to dizziness, it can lead to cramping, definitely leads to cramping, and it can lead to bloated stomach sensation and really irritable bowel. Overhydration cannot really be cured, but dehydration can. So overhydration also impacts performance far more than being dehydrated. Most athletes that are elites or top athletes will run a Comrades or run any race, and they will finish dehydrated and they'll perform from beginning to end. But if you slightly overhydrated, small percentage, it will impact your ability to perform. One of the other things that a lot of elite athletes tell me is that you need to consume between 60 to 90 grams of carbohydrates per hour. And this is often pushed out by scientists who have done testing on how much the body can absorb as far as carbohydrate mixes go, and depending on the intensity somebody's performing it. There's no ways when I'm running I can tell you that I can absorb anywhere near 60 grams of carbohydrates per hour. It's too heavy on my system. I look for something between maybe 30, around 30 to maybe 40 at the most grams of carbohydrates per hour if I'm taking in carbs. I look for more sustainable carbohydrates, especially for an event where I'm running at a better pace. 60 to 90 grams of carbs is a very, very high amount, and I would say that if you're performing at an extremely high intensity and you've got a carbohydrate that can actually oxidize and be absorbed at that rate that you're performing at, well then great, you can go for it, but it's very, very difficult, especially when you're running. So I would look more to the 30 to 40 gram per an hour scenario and taking something that can be easily managed as far as your system goes. Another big mistake that athletes make, and this is something that I always see, is they sometimes put energy in a bottle, and they tend to rely on the bottle for energy. However, if I put, let's say, 50 grams of carbohydrates into a bottle, and I land up at race day and it's cold, what will actually happen as far as consumption goes? I will not be able to consume that amount of liquid per an hour because I'm losing far less liquid or fluid as far as sweat goes. So one of the things that to me is quite critical is that if you're racing and it's cold, it's going to be very, very difficult to consume that amount. Always keep your energy and your fluid requirements separate. Drink to thirst and keep your energy requirements for an hour or for 20 minutes or however you want to do it, and keep that stable. If you are going to rely on a bottle, maybe make it more of a concentrate. As far as it goes, then that way you're actually taking in the least amount of fluid for the maximum amount of energy, and you can rely on water en route, which is no problem at all. So that's very, very key. Just remember to separate those two. Don't put the two together, because in your mind, weather will actually, depending on the temperature, will vary quite significantly. You are going to start off in a bit of cooler temperatures. I don't know what the temperature is going to be by the time you get to Pietermaritzburg. It is an up run this year. I mean, Durban definitely is usually far warmer, but there can be colder temperatures in the day, and if you sweat less, you're going to need to take in less liquid. Don't forget, though, and I mentioned this before, fat is a very big form of fuel. It is very, very critical to be able to tap your fat stores. So let me explain to you, when can you tap your fat stores as a source of energy? Very simple. Your insulin levels need to be at a certain level. You need to be performing at a certain intensity. If you're performing at a very high intensity, in other words, you're puffing and panting and you don't have the ability ready to talk, that means you're quite close to your anaerobic threshold. At that stage, you won't be able to break down fat and use it as a source of fuel. And the reason being is that the body requires oxygen in the process of converting fat into energy. You're not getting enough oxygen into your system because the muscles are demanding it a lot more. But if you're running, and this is Comrades pace, if you're running at Comrades pace, it's a lot lower pace, it's a more comfortable pace, you'd definitely be able to breathe, you'd probably be able to talk quite a bit, okay? And at that kind of a pace, you definitely are capable of utilizing the fat stores. So intensity is the one thing. The second thing is the type of food that you take into your system. So if you're going to take in a gel and you're running and you're performing at a low intensity, and I mentioned this actually earlier, you will spike your blood sugar levels. Insulin will be spiked. So what will happen is the brain will say to the body, well, let's go and get rid of the blood sugar. Forget the fat stores. I've got blood sugar. It's sitting in excess in my bloodstream. Let's utilize that first. Much easier path, quicker accessed, and it will be utilized. And that's why I say insulin management, in other words, eating foods that are maybe more low to medium GI, maybe more medium GI products, are actually are probably better to consume on the day, because it will keep the insulin spark, it will make the brain happy. In other words, the brain also needs as much glucose just as the body. I think it's a 60-40 ratio. You'll want the brain to be a little bit happy, and you've got your fat stores to actually see you through and actually help spare glycogen. So I think insulin management is a very, very big thing on the day. Okay, so like I said before, glycogen stores are limited to around 2,000 calories. It depends on, obviously, your lean muscle mass. You know, fat is unlimited. You can run up to 50 marathons on your fat stores alone. Even if you're 8% body fat, you can run up to 50 marathons on your fat stores alone. Most powerful form of fuel. 1 gram of fat is 2 times more powerful than 1 gram of carbohydrates. If you've ever want to see the power of fat, I'm sure most of you have had a braai. You've seen the fat rip off the meat into the fire, and you've seen those flames explode. That's exactly what happens in your body. Fat is powerful. It's a very powerful form of fuel. Try to maximize the usage. Try and only keep that blood, the insulin-sparking products or blood glucose-sparking products towards the end of the event. You will have a much more stable and a much better comrades race. On race day, I've just given an example of what some of our athletes utilize, and we have got some on the line to ask questions, which we're going to get to shortly. So carbo loading, I always believe low GI is best because, well, it's sustainable. Those carbohydrates will come into play much later on in the race when you actually need them. Before the event, I generally snack on, say, a banana, potato, maybe a food bar or so. I put 32 GI chews in there. Like I said, personal choice. Once in a comfort zone, 20 minutes, I start to feed. And basically then I actually choose my feed depending on the kind of event, whether it's a run, whether it's a triathlon or whatever it is. And I can choose either between I choose a food bowl, accelerator, and do a tablet. At Comrades, I always recommend customers taking a protein carbohydrate drink, probably at the 45 mark or even 40K mark. It will give you a lot of stability. It will keep you feeling fuller for longer. I don't recommend a protein that's going to be too easily and quickly digested, like a whey isolate. I think it's a little bit too fast. It's going to go through your system quickly. Also, it could be susceptible to being lactose intolerant. It can impact the stomach significantly. A soya isolate, I would say, is best. Soya's got a very big benefit. In fact, that it's got phenylalanine, which actually helps with mental focus. So, like caffeine would, not to that extent, but it helps with mental focus. And one of the other things that phenylalanine does is it actually acts as a buffer, and it actually prevents or reduces the onset of muscle cramping. Now you're all probably going to go and buy it, but it is a fact. It makes a very good pre-race drink and during, especially in a long endurance event. This is a slide that I've put up now as far as training in the weeks up to Comrades, and this is not where I'm an expert because I'm not a Comrades running coach or running coach by any means, but I have got some of our other panelists on the line, which I'm going to unmute their mics and I'm going to bring them up, and that is Raymond Orkison and Cuan Walker. Okay, Cuan and Raymond, I've got you. Can you guys hear?
Yeah, can you hear you?
Okay, so Raymond, I mentioned earlier on, Raymond runs a group called Run Ethics. He's a running coach, and he's got a lot of experience. He's a silver medalist at Comrades, and he's got a lot of experience in coaching and training. Cuan knows running intimately as well, coming from Mr. Price. Cuan, are you there?
Yes, I'm here, Mark.
Okay, so I've got Cuan on the line. Cuan comes from Mr. Price Sport. He deals with the Max Elite Runners and a lot of Elite Runners as well, and he also understands running intimately. He's also an SABC commentator. I think it would be good to have him on the line. So, Raymond, I'm going to put it across to you first. Maybe you can just give a little bit of an idea to the people that are on the line as to maybe what they should be doing in as far as training goes and what to be preparing leading up to Comrades.
Yeah, I think we're currently in the taper period. So any you know, any long runs are done, you're kind of finishing off now and winding down. So in your first week of taper, ideally what you're looking at is dropping your total mileage for the week to 70% of your peak week, between 60 to 70%. Your second week would then drop to 50% of your taper, and your third week would then drop to 30%. Over the last couple of sort of 6 weeks in your peak training, there's been a big focus on endurance and getting the miles in. What you're wanting to do now is, as you start dropping your total mileage, you want to start increasing your speed and start getting that speed back into the legs, getting the legs turning over. That also stops your body from, you know, feeling like you're not training, like you're not doing anything. Doesn't damage your muscles, doesn't hurt you, but it keeps you turning over and keeps you feeling fresh and light. It's important to remember that the last week of taper, that last week before Comrades, should really not be seen as a training week. You know, you don't want to be, you know, adding in extra runs, or, you know, you think, I haven't done enough hill repeats. You know, you don't want to be going adding in hill repeats, etc. What's done is done. So the last week is not to be considered as a training week. It's really just a sharpening week, ensuring that you line up at the start fresh and ready to go.
Okay, Raymond. Thanks for that. If there's any questions, please put up your hands and I can unmute you. You can actually ask online, or you can type out your question to us. I'm just running through some questions here, and I actually see that I just mentioned some of them. One person's asked, can I drink low GI endurance energy drink, about 2 liters per day, and not drink water, only drink for carbo loading? In actual fact, it's something that I can mention that, yes, that is actually fine, because it's not an excessive amount of carbohydrates. The other thing is that when you add salt or sugar to a drink, what actually happens is that you actually increase the rate of absorption. So drinking, that's the only, I don't believe in carbo loading before an event, because when you taper down and you naturally keep your eating consistent, you will put your glycogen levels up. But carbo loading in a bottle, like was mentioned there, 32 GI plus liquid, is very beneficial, because not from the carbo loading and the glycogen top up point of view, but from the point of view that it will hydrate you. And hydration is very critical. You need to arrive at that event hydrated. So I hope that answers that question. One of the other things is these slides will be available. So yes, they will be available. I also mentioned before the seminar that anybody that or the webinar that anybody that attended would be getting a voucher, which they can utilize at Discam. All you've got to do is drop me an email, and we can actually, what we do is post those vouchers to you. You can go into any Discam in the country, and you can utilize that voucher. It's a special that we're running at the moment. So you can take one product and you can select another two with it, which is quite nice. Before I go into some of the other questions, I'm just going to hand over to Cuan. Cuan, if there's anything that you would like to say around about leading up to Comrades and pre-race tips, etc., that would be fantastic.
Yeah, just touching on what was mentioned earlier with the taper, with a lot of my elite guys from the Max Elite team, a lot of them would have done all their long runs by now. No one will be doing any more long runs now. It's too close to the race, and any extra bit that you do now towards race day is actually going to be detrimental to you, and you're not going to really achieve much from it. One thing that I'd like to say, though, about the taper is I've seen a lot of people already commenting on Facebook and that, saying that, you know, they started their taper now and their legs are really heavy and they're feeling sore from just running a 10K run. But you must remember that you are loading your body with all of that training, and now your body is basically not knowing what's going on, because you have, taken a lot of the workload off. So people mustn't worry at this stage if you are feeling a little bit stiff, because that stiffness and like lethargic feeling will go away with time.
Okay, that's great. Kieran, just by the way, is Prodigal with you at the moment?
Yes, Prodigal is here with
me. I mean, is there anybody in the audience that would like to ask any questions? I'll go through some of them as well, and maybe Prodigal might be able to answer as well. Somebody wrote here actually, can I mix 32 GI tubes, chews and tablets, or is there a formula? I mean, that was Yatish. Yatish, you can definitely mix the two together. I think I think it's just, it doesn't matter which of the two you're going to take on the day. I think it's the quantity of the carbohydrates that you need to look at. Now, there is a difference between them. The Endure tablets are low GI. They're far slower releasing than the chews. The chews are more at a sugar response level of a banana. Okay, and I would look at probably consuming food more at that level. If you're going to take the endurance tablets, I would only take them earlier on, but I would look at probably the chews or the accelerate tablets further on in the event, because they provide a much quicker release, and they'll give you a better feel. The chews I take every 25 to 30 minutes. Usually when I'm actually racing, I would look at a tablet probably every 20 minutes. So it's a bit more frequent because it's a smaller amount of carbohydrates that you're taking in at once, but you would need to make the feed more frequent. But it's, again, it's a small tablet, and you can take water with it en route. Another question that was asked was, I'm on a low carbohydrate, half-fat diet. I'm able to run long, slow runs up to 4 hours and 1 teaspoon of coconut oil and water. Coconut oil, by the way, is probably the most quickly accessible fat. It's an excellent fat to access as a source of energy. And that just shows you the power of fats. I'm actually quite happy to see that. When taking 32 GI pre-race drink, I get a mild sugar headache of late. I've just been taking half a chew every 30 minutes with a few macadamia nuts every 2 hours. Do I think it'll get you through Comrades? So for somebody that's eliminated sugar completely through their diet, I would say that you can take small amounts. I'm one of those people that also looks at low carbohydrate, high fat. So what I do is, like, when I'm taking the drink, I actually dilute it. As opposed to having two scoops, I only have one scoop, and I dilute it a lot more with water, and I take less carbohydrate feed through an event. But the chews I find for me are a little bit easier, or the endurance tablets a little bit easier on the long, slower sessions. On the fast-paced sessions, I look at the accelerate. I would look at accelerate tablets. Somebody's asked me to talk about fat store tapping again. I'm not 100% sure what you want me to repeat there, but if you consume something that is a glucose spiking product, in other words, you flood your system with glucose, you won't be able to really utilize your fat stores, because the brain will take the shorter path. So what we're saying is to consume foods that give you a bit of a lower insulin spark, okay, that allow you to utilize your fat stores and keep your brain a little bit happy, and that tends to work very, very well. It's quite interesting to see that. I mean, if you look at some of the elite runners, and maybe Prodigal can answer this as well, I don't see them eating or taking in a lot of food en route. And that's not it's a very high intensity as well that a lot of them are racing. Prodigal, I mean, when you're racing, maybe you can give us an idea of how you feed and how you drink en route.
Yes, Mark. To be honest with you, as you said earlier on, that overhydrating is a problem. I found that when I'm racing, it's like I'm diluting the electrolytes that left in the body. So you must be careful when you're taking water and any supplements that you're taking on the road. Don't take new stuff on the road that you haven't used when you're training. And like me, I'm sponsored by K2GI, I take the endurance during the race. And what I do the last week of the race, the first 3 days I'll check recovery, then the last 3 days I'll do my carb loading with endurance. And during the race, as you're saying, Mark, that you mustn't check water when you're not needing it, I found that it makes my body heavy and having like stitches. That's all I can say, Mark.
Okay, yeah, I think it's very important to mention. I spoke about overhydration earlier. If you consume an excessive amount of water, what's going to happen is you're going to dilute your electrolyte levels, and that is going to lead to cramping. You can correct me if I'm wrong, but usually at Comrades, they have water tables every like 2.5 kilometers. I think that's right, okay, Kieran, it's every 2.5.
In the beginning it's about 2.5, but there's some where it gets to 1K, 1.5. There's actually too many water tables, but that's just my opinion.
Okay, so what the organizers are, they're focused on don't dehydrate, but one of the biggest issues is that I mean, I've had a lot of customers that have come to me after Comrades and said it was the worst Comrades of my life. And the first thing I'll do is say, let's analyze your water consumption. And the funny thing is that they started taking water from table one up until 20 kilometers. Every table, a sip, sip, sip. And those sips added up. I would generally only go for water when I'm thirsty, and that could be only at the 20-kilometer mark. If it's cold, maybe only at the 30-kilometer mark, I might take in a bit of water. Remember, you can perform dehydrated, but you cannot perform overhydrated. Manage your water intake according to you were born with a God-given mechanism, which is thirst. When thirst triggers, drink to it. Don't overdo it, but drink. Drink until when that thirst is gone, then carry on without it until you need it again. Drinking too frequently can lead to issues in there. So I think that's very critical, is to understand that. I've got Shaun Meiklejohn on. Shaun, you won Comrades, actually. I'm going to actually unmute you. Can you hear me, Shaun?
I can, Mark, yeah.
Okay, it's great to have you on. Shaun's a gold medalist and winner, a multiple gold medalist, and obviously winner of Comrades Marathon in 95. He runs for the Nedbank Running Club, and I think it would be great. He's just mentioned to do. He's advised as well on some pre-race tapering. So maybe you can just mention what you told me.
Yeah, my pre-race tapering started probably a week ago, where my maximum mileage these days is nowhere what it was in the mid-90s, but I sort of peak at about 140-145 k's and then drop it down to 110 this week that we're currently in, and then next week I'll probably only do about 80 or 90 k's, and obviously race day will be upon us.
Shaun, just a quick question, because you're one of those athletes that uses the Accelerate tablets, I think. What can you give us an idea of the kind of nutrition that, the nutrition regime you've got during race day?
I use the tablets from a convenience point of view, mostly on my training runs where I don't get seconding. And I'd run for the first hour probably just on a bit of water, and then I'll start taking the Accelerate tabs with water. And once I'm on them after an hour or 70-odd minutes, I find I benefit if I have one every roughly 20 minutes or so. When it comes to a race like Comrades, where I have access to some personal seconding along the route, I mix a slightly bigger drink, roughly 400 mils of Accelerate in the liquid form, and I start drinking that also after the first hour into the event. And I'm drinking about 400 mils every 6 kilometers, or when I'm comfortable. I don't always finish the bottle. I drink till I feel satisfied and comfortably full, and I'll do that for the duration of Comrades. I think in the years gone by, when I used to drink more frequently, I used to drink every 3 kilometers, but I only had roughly 200 mils. And I think the advice I was given those days, and what I found worked for me, was I didn't have more than maybe 600-700 mils per hour.
Okay, and you're also running at quite a high pace compared to, I'd say, the general runner these days. So you're probably losing a lot more liquid as well. So at that pace, to be drinking about 700 mils per hour would probably be correct.
Yeah, that's what I found worked perfectly well for me. When I finished the race, I was always breaking out in a sweat, and I never at any stage felt that I was, at risk of being dehydrated or overhydrated, for that matter.
Well, that's great. I mean, liquid management is what it's about, really, on the day, and I think a lot of people battle with that. One of the questions I've got here is what are your thoughts on using caffeine? And I think that's actually quite a critical question. I did mention it earlier on, and what I wanted to say about caffeine is the following: is that if you are not caffeine intolerant, caffeine doesn't really play a massive role on the day. It really doesn't. If you are caffeine intolerant, in other words, you haven't taken any caffeine in probably the week I'd say 7 to 10 days before the event. In other words, you've mitigated the coffee, etc., from your diet, and then you take on race day when you get up. You need to take it about 3 hours before the race, so it's quite early on. I would say even up to 4 hours to prevent any, because it does act as a diuretic. If you take 1 milligram to 2 milligrams of caffeine per kilogram of body weight, which is a significant amount, what caffeine does is it flushes a large amount of free fatty acids into the bloodstream. And those become very accessible as far as fuel usage goes. So in other words, you're maximizing your ability to utilize more, I call it quick fat fuel, as opposed to trying to break it down, etc. It's already sitting in the bloodstream in the form of free fatty acids, and it becomes more accessible, and you're able to flood it with caffeine. If you're not caffeine, if you're obviously caffeine tolerant and you drink coffee all the time, it's not going to play a role, a significant role like that. The only other benefit of caffeine during a race, I would say really at Comrades, you shouldn't really be taking it all the time because it does act as a diuretic. You have to obviously consume more liquid. It's not the most comfortable thing. Also, caffeine causes acidity in the stomach, so you can lead to stomach irritation. But towards the end of the race, if you wanted to pick me up or wake me up, I would say that that would be fine because then the caffeine would only really, maybe for the last hour or so, I would say. There are some athletes who can't do without caffeine, and probably those are the ones that are probably more tolerant towards it. I don't know if any of the Shaun, I don't know if you or if Cuan or if anybody else has used caffeine during Comrades race at all. Have any of you used it?
Not during the race. In the early years, that theory that you mentioned about caffeine and the benefit that it has, I was sort of led to believe that what it stimulated your body to access the fatty acids for source of energy by having the caffeine, and would spare your other sort of energy reserves like your glycogen and that, and switch to them later. I don't know if there's any truth in that.
If the fat's available, it will definitely help spare glycogen. But again, if you're performing at a very, very high intensity, it's very difficult to utilize fat because, like I mentioned earlier, you require a significant amount of oxygen in the conversion process. So it depends really on the pace that you're going at. But it does provide you a large amount of fat, which helps spare glycogen. So they're correct in what they said. I think that it just needed to be probably a little bit more clarified.
Okay.
I'm just looking at the questions that we're getting at the moment. Your recommendation of 40 grams of carbs per night in my system without using any gels. Look, the gels are for me personally. I haven't used gels for many, many years because of the sparking mechanism. In a race like Comrades, I just don't want to. Take in a product that's going to spike my blood sugar levels and then leave me dropping and feeling very terrible later on. And that's exactly what does happen. Like I said, insulin management is what it's about. You can easily take in 30 to 40 grams of carbohydrates per hour without using gels. If I look at that, you're talking about maybe a banana within an hour would give you about 30 grams, 25 to 30 grams worth of carbohydrates. Throw a little bit of energy drink or a tablet or so here or there or a bar. I mean, if I cut up a bar into various pieces or spreading it. But the other thing is you've got to remember if you're managing your insulin, okay, you'll be able to use your fat stores more. If you depend on a gel, you're going to have to take those gels consistently and frequently in order to keep those blood sugar levels stable. You're not going to be able to get away from it. Once you start taking a gel, it's not even every hour that you need to take the gel. I would say you need to consume one every 45 minutes. And by the time you get to 60, 70 kilometers, I think it's going to be very, very painful on your system, especially if you're running 9, 10 hours and longer. Somebody's asked if there's a formula to calculate how many carbs, packets, service one would need to take with you. If you're looking at running 12 hours, generally, like I said, I go with a tablet every 20 minutes. I was speaking to Drew Fisher, who couldn't join us this evening. He's a 6:30 Comrades marathon runner. He chews two Accelerate tablets every 20 minutes while he's racing. which is quite a large amount. I'm just looking at all the questions here just to see.
Can I just add in there?
Yeah, for sure. I'm just going to cut out the market. It's getting a bit of back feed.
Yeah, I think when it comes to carb intake during the run, it's obviously important to keep that blood sugar level up. That's what's feeding the brain. The moment that drops, your brain gets fatigued. And if your brain gets fatigued, your legs can be as strong as they like. You're gonna slow down. So it's important to keep those carbs coming in. But I think it's also in the same token, it's important to listen to your body and to look for the signs that your body's giving you. So, if you're consuming carbs, every 20 minutes, 40 minutes, whatever your intake is, and you start to feel nauseous, etc. You need to listen to that. That's generally that nausea is coming from excess carbs. So at that point, cut the carbs out. Wait until that nausea passes, start taking liquids again, and then reintroducing the carbs slowly. So I think it's important to listen to the signals that your body is giving you, while you're out on the run, especially for the most of the field, which is out there for between 10 and 12 hours.
Yeah, I agree with you, Raymond. I mean, a lot of people think that the nausea is normal, and it's not. It's really usually excessive glucose intake or excessive liquid intake, and that's why it needs to be managed very carefully. The one thing that Raymond mentioned, I think, is very important to understand. The term bonking or hitting the wall, fatigue, is not actually your muscles fatiguing. It's the brain shutting down those muscles because the brain is not happy that it's not getting sufficient fuel. So, like I said before, 60% of what you take in feeds the muscles, 40% the brain. The brain needs to be happy. If you're feeding it a very sustainable and stable, and I call it drip feeding over small drip feeds over a period of time, there's no ways you're going to tire. You'll be able to take advantage of your fat stores. You'll be able to take advantage of basically spreading out that feed along route, and you'll feel a lot more comfortable. The more frequent you can feed in the beginning, the far more beneficial and the far stronger you're going to actually feel in the end. I'm just going through some more questions over here. Drinking 2 liters, that one I think I've already answered. Is 60 grams of carbs per an hour too much, energy drink being the source? I don't think it's too much. I think it depends on there's one thing I need to say, and this is very, very clear. Every single person that's racing Comrades, or any race, in any endurance event for that matter, has got different requirements. Some can take in and absorb 60, 70 grams of carbohydrates, and it depends on what kind of carbohydrates are, but some can't. The ones that actually can really take in that amount of carbohydrates, or should be, are actually the ones that are performing at a much higher intensity. And those are the guys that are going like sub 7 hours. They're really performing at quite a high pace. And possibly they're burning off a higher rate of calories, so they need to try and take it as much. You can never replace calories lost, but you can look at probably at around 20 to 30% of replacement. So the thing is that you need to try and understand that there's no ways running at a slow pace and taking too many calories, you're not going to be able to absorb and utilize that. But running at a much higher pace and taking in the right calories, you will be able to. So yeah, for some people, there are people that can absorb 70, 80, 90 grams of carbohydrate. It really depends on your body. It depends how well-trained your gut is. And it also depends on the kind of intensity that you're performing at and the kind of carbohydrates that you're taking in. And that's very, very key to mention. Shaun actually mentioned that there's a lot of runners that start throwing up a few hours into the run. At Comrades, is that too much carbohydrates? I think it can be what Raymond mentioned. It can be excessive carbohydrate intake, but I wouldn't say excessive carbohydrate intake is more as opposed to excessive glucose intake. In other words, quite a high glucose intake of carbs. I think that can definitely make you feel nauseous. I don't eat sugar. I can tell you now. After a couple of weeks, if I have to have a little bit of sugar, I feel nauseous for hours afterwards. So you can imagine somebody that overloads on sugar, even if they're sugar dependent, they will feel nauseous. Definitely, it's one of the things that you'll notice. But at the same time, if you're taking too much liquid, it can also lead to nausea. It can lead to disorientation. It can lead to dizziness. Hyponatremia is actually something that's that happens a lot at Comrades, and mainly because of the liquid feed that's out there. I'm just running through some. There's a lot of questions over here. I use the chews and tabs at Ironman. I found the tabs made me thirsty. How much do I drink? If I drink to thirst, I drink too much. Okay, so that's actually a very, very good question, because sometimes flavorants and colorants in products can make you a little bit more thirsty, depending on the kind of palate you've got. But one of the things that the tablets and one thing is the carbohydrates and salts do is they help with the absorption. So if it does make you a little bit more thirsty and you're drinking it a little bit more, it possibly will help absorb it a little bit better into the system. But you need to, in the back of your mind, have a bit of a measurement as to the amount of liquid you are going to be taking in on the day, and try not to exceed that. If you are feeling thirsty because of you taking in the carbohydrate, rather take the water, swish it around your mouth, and swirl it around to try and get rid of that taste, as opposed to swallowing the liquid. If you're taking in around 600 mils, usually in training, and you're used to that, and you're taking 600 mils per hour in Comrades during race day, that's fine. But I would be very careful about overdoing it with the liquid. Try and measure how much you're actually consuming per an hour, or even per 20 minutes, and try and stick to that if you are used to it. Don't overdo it. If you land up drinking, if you're running a 9 to 12, or let's say 9 to even to 10 hour Comrades, and you're drinking 750 mils of water per an hour, that might be a little bit too much for some people. It actually might be excessive. Shaun mentioned earlier that that's what he consumed per an hour, and that was running at a much higher intensity. He was obviously losing a lot more liquid. But you need to try and understand what your body's abilities are of absorbing, and obviously the kind of sweat rate. I can get very technical on this because I've done it over the years, where I've actually gone out in the mornings. I've measured myself before I've gone on a run. I've gone running for 2 hours with no liquid whatsoever. I've come back and I've actually measured my weight again. And I've done that in various conditions, various temperature conditions, to see how much liquid my body loses and how much I would need to take in to try and create a balance. I don't know if any of you have actually tried that. It works very well, and it's something that you could try in the future. You know, is actually seeing how much liquid your body actually loses and how much would be required to replace it. I'm just Raymond. I don't know if there's anything anybody wants to add to that.
I hear what that. What that question is asking, you know, I've experienced the same thing where you're thirsty and you're taking on liquid, but you're just feeling this water squish around in your stomach. And what I find helps with that is to take something like a rehydrate sport or a hydroassist. Hydroassist works very well. You take it, you know, at the 30K mark, 60K mark kind of thing, and that just helps absorb that water into the system and actually clears that stomach. So I found that actually helps when you're struggling with that kind of thing.
Okay, that's an important point. And I often get asked by athletes, should I take salt tablets or is it a requirement? And like I tell them, the salt tablets aren't there to prevent cramping. They're actually there to help with the water absorption and get it into the system. So it's because overhydration can dilute your electrolyte levels and actually cause issues. So taking in a salt tablet is not something that I recommend, but generally, when you're running in temperatures that are slightly hotter, or when you're running or doing events that are slightly longer, and you do feel that your stomach is full, you're taking in something like an electrolyte, like Raymond mentioned, the Hydroassist is got a higher salt content. It will help actually absorb and get that water utilized. So that could be something. Cuan, I don't know if any of your guys have ever tried playing with salt tablets at all.
Yes, Mark, some of our guys have done the salt tablets, but as you said, that they're used to get the water through to the muscles. Most of the time, the guys take it too late, and they only start using it after they started cramping. I'm not too sure, Prodigal, if you used anything like that before.
Yes. I'm currently using them, and I check them at halfway in whatever race that I'm running. Like, I've learned the hard way from my first Comrades 2008, where I lost about 10 minutes because of cramps. Then since from last year, I've been using 30GI tablets and they're working amazingly. No cramping. Last year I ran 543 without cramps. They are working from.
Okay, so just to mention that the tablets that Prodigal is talking about, we haven't actually released into market yet. They magnesium tablets. I'm just hearing a bit of back noise. They're actually magnesium tablets, which I gave him to try. And magnesium obviously can assist in cramp prevention. But the problem is that, like I tell people, 99% of the time, cramps are caused by two things. Okay, the first is undertrained muscles, and that's a fact. If you haven't trained at the correct intensity for Comrades in training, you will cramp. And I'm not saying that it's got to be fast or slow. And Raymond, you can come in on this after. I'll ask you to come and comment on this. But if you're performing at a very high intensity during training, when you get to Comrades, you're going to be running at a much lower intensity. You're using different muscle fibers. You've got slow and fast twitch fibers. The one is used is a more explosive muscle. And if your endurance on that muscle is actually very good, but your endurance on your slower twitch fiber muscles are actually quite low, what will actually happen is that you can actually lead to cramping. The second biggest reason for cramping at Comrades, without a doubt, is overhydration. It's dilution of electrolyte levels. It's not really dehydration. They've shown that the amount of people that cramp from dehydration is very small. It's only those that have got a rarity as far as electrolyte loss goes through sweat. And sweat is hypertonic. You actually lose more liquid than you do salt when you're actually sweating out fluid. Raymond, I don't know if you want to comment on that.
Yeah, I think often what you find is guys will come and run Comrades and they start cramping at 30Ks, 40Ks. They can't understand it because, you know, in all their long runs they didn't cramp. And that's where your Comrades training pace is so critical. If you're coming into Comrades and you're running at a different pace to what you've been training, you're going to cramp. Most runners training for Comrades will tend to run closer to their marathon time. I'm talking about the bulk of the field. And the problem with that marathon time is when you get to Comrades, there's no way you're going to maintain that marathon pace across two marathons and then some. So your muscles, the faster you run, the more you get onto your forefoot. The slower run, the further you get onto your back foot. So the muscles have been trained in a completely different way. So it's crucial that you set out at Comrades at the same pace that you've been training at. That's the biggest causes of cramps on the day, especially early cramps.
Thanks for that, Raymond. Shaun, there was a bit of back noise. I actually had you muted there for a sec. Is there anything that you wanted to add to that? Yeah. I think he's got his kids there. Shaun?
I popped away for a second, Mark.
No, sorry. No, we were talking about cramping at Comrades, and we're talking about salt intake and lack of training on muscles, etc. I was just wondering if there's anything you'd like to add to that. I mean, from your experience as far as cramping goes.
Yeah, fortunately, in recent years, haven't suffered much with cramping, and I'm hoping that sort of my hydration and diet and everything and the preparation and training has been good. But I used to get cramps quite severely in the early days, and I remember Bruce Fordyce watching, I think it was a down run going down Polly's, down Fields Hill, sorry, and I started cramping so badly, and when I watched the tapes afterwards, his advice was, whatever you do, don't stop running. You just got to keep on moving and change your running stride or run pigeon-toed or duck foot to try and change the sort of stress on the various muscles to help it go away. But the cramps were so bad, I ground to a standstill just before Westall. And I think it's just really, besides the liquid intake of that, I think cramping is a sign of a tired muscle, and a lot of adaption takes place over the years, and I found that the more I've run in my running career, the less of a problem I've had with cramping, and the body's obviously adapted to the rigors of ultra distance running, combined with, you know, good nutrition and liquid intake.
Okay, that's great. So I think that's quite important to know. So there's a few, there's been a few answers on cramping there, and I think managing high managing hydration and obviously making sure that you train and race the same intensity. Don't get caught up in the in that whirlwind of trying to keep a pace up with somebody that's running at a higher pace than you. You know, rather start, it's your own race, it's nobody else's race. Run in your own comfort zone and get to the finish in your own comfort zone. And I think that you'll probably have a far better comrades. I'm just trying to see if there are any more questions at all that we haven't possibly answered. Insulin spikes, do they happen during racing? Definitely do happen during racing. Based on the kind of intake of type of carbohydrates or food sources you're going to take in. Because remember, when you're racing, an insulin spike is flattened, but it depends on how it's going to be flattened by the rate of intensity that you're performing at. If I'm racing a 10K and I'm running at a very high intensity when I'm puffing and panting and I'm taking in something that's a very fast-releasing gel, usually those things have got a G. You've got to understand, from a glycemic index point of view, gels can have a GI of up to 130, 140, especially if they're multidextrin-based. And generally, I mean, anything over the hundreds is like putting a glucose drip in your arm. If you're not performing at a very high intensity, I can tell you now that it is going to not be taken up, and you will have an insulin spike. So you will have a bit of a roller coaster ride. If you think about your energy levels, it is a roller coaster ride. It's up and down. The more flat you can actually maintain and keep that curve, the far better you're going to benefit from your race and from the feet. So I mean, insulin spikes do happen in racing. I've seen it many times before, and let me tell you, I've seen it happening with pro athletes as well, which is actually incredible. They actually take a product which is a high spiking before race, and they'll find that an hour and a half into the race, they actually completely collapse and lose. Why? Because they feel good, and then later on they feel bad. And that's when you know that your food is not right, is that feel good, feel bad feeling. When you're feeling great, and then feeling on top of the world, and then you're suddenly feeling at the bottom of the world, and that really, really makes a difference. I've just apologized. I don't know which slide you're seeing on the screen, but I believe that it was stuck on slide 2 on some people's screens, but these slides will be made available to everybody. We are going to, I am recording this session. Like I said, it will be made available on YouTube. So the entire discussion will actually be made available on YouTube. I'm just trying to see if there's any questions that have come up that we haven't answered. Okay, is there anybody, if there's anybody that wants to ask a question and wants me to unmute their mics, they can actually just put up your hand, and I'll unmute you. You can actually ask online if you want, and we've got the ability to answer you. Is there anybody that wants to ask any questions? Okay, so nobody. So I've got some more polls that I actually wanted to put up. If you guys could be so kind to answer this one. Just a quite interesting one. Do you currently use 32GR? That will be quite interesting. By the way, we are going to be at the Comrades Expo. You're welcome to come and chat to us anytime. Some of our pro athletes will also be around the Comrades Expo as well. And we'll be there to help as much as possible. If there's any questions after this, you're welcome to email us at info@32gr.com, and definitely we'll answer you. Not a problem at all. We are going to be releasing a Comrades Nutrition Guide as well. The other thing is that we have got, as far as the panelists that go, like Cuan Walker or Run Ethics Raymond, you can go onto his website. You can always contact him as well. If you are interested in coaching or you're interested in any advice, you can do that. I see some, a few more questions have come up here. Once Comrades is complete, how long should one rest before starting running again? In actual fact, that's not for me to answer. I can just say to you one thing, that for me, after a marathon, it takes, it's just a marathon, it takes about 7 weeks to 8 weeks on a cellular level, on a cellular level, to properly recover from those events. Mentally, I'm probably ready to run quite soon afterwards, but I've made the mistake through my sort of athletics career where I've actually gone and started training too quickly after an event, and I've actually landed up burning myself out and ending up with fatigue. So, you know, the, you know, science has shown that on a cellular level, it definitely takes a while to recover. Raymond, maybe you can, you can, you can, you and Cuan can actually come into that one.
Yeah, I find for novice runners, it's quite a shock to the system, and generally you're looking, you know, at least 4 to 6 weeks, you know, off your legs. I think it's fine to start introducing some swimming and stuff that you're not, where you're not putting any strain on the on those legs. But certainly for a novice runner, I would go with a minimum of 6 weeks off the legs, just to give them a full, good chance of recovery. Your full recovery is going to take a little bit longer than that. I wouldn't rush too quickly to get back into it. The more Comrades you've done, the stronger your body is, the quicker you tend to recover. So after a good couple of Comrades, generally sort of 2 weeks, and you can start getting back to some light training and you know, start looking at some speed work to start getting your speed base up before the next Comrades. That's certainly what I've found.
Thanks, Raymond. Cuan, anything from you on like how long it takes to recover from a Comrades?
Yeah, I think it's very different between all the different runners in that. But as Raymond was saying, obviously the novice runner would need to take more time off. But a lot of my elite guys, some actually will take about a week of no running, and then they'll start doing some just light, gentle jogging. But within a month of Comrades, some of them are running PBs over 10K. I know Prodigal is one of them who, within a month after Comrades, ran a 30-30-10K, and all he did was introduce some speed work into it. He had the big base from Comrades, and he also won City after like quite close to Comrades. Prodigal, how long do you normally take off from Comrades, and what would you recommend?
Yeah, as you're saying, that we're all different. What I do is I take 2 weeks after Comrades without running, then the other 2 weeks I start jog for the next 2 weeks. Then the first month after Comrades, then I'll start my proper training.
Okay, I think, look, I think for a lot of people, sometimes they make the mistake of thinking they recovered, and I think it's a matter of just listen to your body. There are signs of fatigue, by the way. There's three that I always look at. One of the biggest signs is difficulty of actually falling asleep at night. If you wake up, if you can't, if you're tossing and turning and you battle to fall asleep at night, everybody's going to tell me, yeah, but that's me, because I battle to fall asleep at night anyway. But generally, it will be a little bit more excessive. That's a sign of fatigue. Elevated heart rate, rest rate in the morning is another sign of fatigue. If I take my rest rate every single day, I can tell when it's even 5-10% elevated, and that's definitely a sign of tone down your training, because you're actually going into... So those are the two big ones that I really look at. The third one is really just how you feel, your energy levels, your times are dwindling, you're not able to put in a performance like you normally used to. Sometimes you need to take a back step, recover. You don't lose fitness. I had to stop training for nearly 4 months of this year due to illness, which was actually devastational, because I had to pull out of Comrades. I've come back now after 4 months. I'm not at the fitness that I was at before, but I'm already running pretty close to my marathon pace, which is actually quite awesome. So it's not that you're going to lose fitness for a week or two taken off. You'll actually get a lot stronger, and I think that's something to have in mind. Rest is very critical. There are some more questions on the site here. I'm actually going to launch another poll for you guys in the meantime. I don't know if you can see that on your screens. So it's just interesting to see around Comrades how many you've done. Maybe there's some that haven't done any here as well, which is also quite interesting. In the meantime, one of the other questions that that I've actually seen on the screen here is, would you recommend alternating accelerate tabs and choose to keep your level steady and give you a bit of a boost? Look, the accelerate tablets give you a bit of a pickup because it's a faster, they've got a GI of around 76. They are a faster releasing carbohydrate. And generally for the athlete that's performing at a high intensity, I like to actually use the accelerate tablets when I'm racing. And I like to use the twos when I'm racing as well. I find that the two work quite well together. Accelerate I use more towards the end and the twos I use in the beginning. There's no problem combining the two together. Because the tablets are actually only 5 grams of carbohydrates per tablet, it's not going to really overload your system. You're actually going to absorb that tablet and use it quite quickly. It's not going to up you and drop you. So I wouldn't stress too much about that at all. Ian actually asked me where I'm putting the polls. That's where they are. Sorry, Ian. Before, I actually didn't launch them properly the way I wanted to, so I see that now. What would you recommend is recovery nutrition after Comrades to avoid illness? Sure. I usually worry about illness before Comrades. Afterwards, let it happen after Comrades or let it happen after any race. But so it's actually a very good question because at the moment when I work with professional athletes and I work around the nutrition side of things, for example, one of my Australian, she's a pro triathlete at the moment, she's actually got an issue with illness. And unfortunately, we don't want it to hamper the training, but we need to make sure she's recovered so she can get back into training again. So there's a few things that I focus on. Number one, you need to watch your nutrition. There's things that actually feed on illness, viruses, etc. Things like sugar, you should definitely cut out completely. Things that are high in bacteria, so such as dairy or even organic products are high in bacteria. I mean, I advocate organic, but when you're sick, you should probably eliminate them a little bit more, especially if you've got a viral infection or bacterial infection because of thrives. They've got a much higher bacteria rate. Another thing is to cut out things like magnesium supplements because it doesn't just feed your muscles. It doesn't just generate ATP to feed your muscles. It feeds your generates ATP to feed the viral load as well. Some of the things, as far as supplements go, I mean, I generally, leading up to a big event, I actually take a Neurobion injection once a week. I actually combine it with a vitamin B complex. I think that is very critical in keeping my vitamin B levels up, especially before a Comrades event where you've been doing so much mileage. It doesn't harm you. You can't overdose on it. And it is 100% legal. You cannot get into trouble. It's not waiver prohibited. If it's a vitamin B, it's just taken intramuscularly is the best way to take it. It's far better absorbed, and it works like a bomb. You can go to any of your discounts and ask the nurse to give you the injection. Definitely ask for the Neurobion. If you're brave enough, you can combine it with a vitamin B complex, which is your riboflavins and everything in between. That's a 1, 6, and 12. As far as supplements go, vitamin C is quite critical. I would recommend taking probably 1 to 3,000 milligrams a day. Again, take an esterified vitamin C that's much better absorbed by the body. And it's a buffer, so it's got a higher bioavailability. Specifically, I use Solgar. I find it works very well. Solel's excellent, but it impacts my stomach. But I find the Solgar very easy on my digestive system. Glutamine is another product that I would recommend maybe to help get rid of the fatigue. Leading up to Comrades, it's actually not a bad idea to go into glutamine. You could take it morning and night on an empty stomach or even just after a training run with a recovery shake on an empty stomach. There are glutamines and there are glutamines in the market. As far as glutamine goes, I would actually recommend Muscle Farm from Dis-Chem. It's more expensive than the glutamines. It's got all the strains. It is also under informed choice, which means it is tested for prohibited substances on an ongoing basis to make sure that it's clean and clear of any prohibited additives. So definitely something that you can trust and it is safe. The other thing that I definitely recommend is taking something like ZMA. It's a zinc-magnesium bond. It's not zinc and magnesium separately. It's a bond together. Best time to take it is before you go to sleep at night, probably as you're closing your eyes, because if you don't, it does have the property of maybe keeping you awake, so you've got like an hour to fall asleep. So that also works quite well in helping keep your immunity up. There's many things. I mean, there's if you go to some of the health shops, there's immunity drops that you can actually take and put them under your tongue. There's multivitamins. There's three that I recommend, which I know, you know, personally, some people would recommend their own. But I look at Viridian. I look at Solgar. The Omnium is very good. And South African brand, if you look at Stamina Grow, it's also an excellent multivitamin, which actually helps keep your immunity and your energy levels up. So those are just some of the ideas. But the best way to keep your immunity up is not just on supplements. It's actually eating consistently through the day from the time you wake up to the time you go to sleep. You cannot go and change your diet overnight, so don't go and do anything extreme. If you're all of a sudden going to cut out coffee, understand that you might have a bit of an impact on your system because it actually could impact you a little bit negatively, just cutting out certain food groups that you're used to eating, and that can also affect immunity. So that's just something that I wanted to stress. If you're eating, as far as your immune system goes, eating for your immune system, keep your, I mean, if you looked at the slides, keep your sugar content to a minimum. Keep your, rather go with complex carbohydrates. Plenty of vegetables and fruit is the way to go. And obviously lean meats and proteins and very healthy oils. If you're eating all of that, I promise you your immunity will be good and you'll be able to actually get to race day in one piece for sure. Don't panic if you do get sick. You know, all the big mileage is over. I think that, you know, rather focus now on getting to race day quite healthily. Somebody asked about Future Life products for Comrades. I'm not sure if that is, when you say for Comrades, is that drinking it through Comrades or drinking it before Comrades? I'm not sure. I mentioned Future Life as a product on race day. It's fine. It's a soya-based product. It does have carbohydrate and protein in it, and I don't find anything wrong with that as far as a pre-race meal goes. I would obviously add in some fruit or something to increase the amount of calories that you're taking in. Baraka, somebody's mentioned that they take it every morning and it's recommended for build-up to Comrades. Look, Baraka is a calcium and it's got a calcium compound in it with vitamin C. I generally don't like to take calcium with vitamin C. I think it's wrong because one gives to the body, one takes from the body, and the two sort of conflict with each other. I prefer taking vitamins in isolation so that they don't compete with each other for absorption. So if I'm going to take calcium or I'm going to take vitamin C, I'd rather take them at separate times. And that's just a personal view. You know, if you take a concoction with too many things in the mix, the absorption rate's going to be low because they will fight for absorption. Another thing is if you're taking vitamin C, don't take it with a carbohydrate. Rather take it with a protein because the carbohydrates and the vitamin C are going to fight for absorption. And that's a fact. So these are just some of the things that I'm putting across to you, and you know, maybe it will trigger. And rather split your vitamins through the day, you know, from morning to night. It doesn't matter at what stage you're taking because it's over a 24-hour period, but better to do that than to clash. I think we've been on for quite a while. I'm gonna just close. I think at the moment, like I said, if there's any further questions, you're welcome to contact us directly or anybody that was in the panel here. From my side, I just want to thank everybody for coming onto the webinar. We had a very good attendance this evening. I'm going to throw one more poll at you. Then it's the last poll is what you feel is critical to performance, or how you feel nutrition is critical to performance in an event, and it will be interesting to see how you vote on that. So I just want to thank you very much for attending the webinar. I just want to say thank you to Raymond and to Cuan and to Prodigal and to Shaun for coming on, because it's great to have expertise and people with their knowledge when it comes to running. Maybe Kuan's actually, since we've got an SABC commentator on with us, maybe it would be actually great to hear what his thoughts are as far as who he thinks might win Comrades this year, or his top five picks for Comrades this year. Kuan, any ideas? Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, Mark, you know, when it comes to predicting Comrades, it's sort of like predicting the lotto numbers. You can never get it right. It's such a long race and anything can happen on the day. But amongst the men, you can't count out Stephen Mujingi. He had a bad Two Oceans, but he's won the Comrades three times. And from his training camp, they said that he's fine and well prepared for this year's race. So I think it's going to be between Mujingi, definitely Marco Mumbo. He's won Two Oceans three times before. He debuted last year in Comrades, finishing fourth. I think those two guys are going to really have a great race. And then people like Jeff Kelehe, Fani Machipa, they always ever improving. Prodigal Kumalo as well, next to me. He'll be looking for a top 10 definitely. And yeah, it's going to be a good race. In the women's race, I don't know if anyone knows, but about an hour ago, the story broke that the Russian lady, Natalia Volgina, who won Two Oceans, she's tested positive. So she was one of the women that I had down for Comrades. So I think it's going to be another episode of the twins dominating Comrades again. I had Volgina and Ellie Greenwood down to take them on. But Ellie's also pulled up with an injury now. So, yeah, I think it's going to be the twins. And I'm quite interested to see the debut runs by Tabitha Sata, who was second in Two Oceans, and the South African lady, Shaun Bosman. It's quite interesting to see what she'll do in Comrades.
And Kerry Kuhn would be a great one as well, I think, for the ladies again.
And Kerry Kuhn as well, yeah. She's always improving in Comrades. I think she ran about a 6:45 last year, and she's a really, really strong runner. Also does well on the trail running scene. So on an up run, it's not always about speed and faster times. It's more about the endurance, and she's a very, very strong athlete.
Okay, well, that's great. Thanks to you and Prodigal for coming on. Prodigal, thanks very much. Thank you, Shaun. Raymond, any last words from you?
No, not at this point. Just wish everyone good luck, and don't panic out there. Just take the day as it comes and enjoy every minute of it.
Okay, so like I said, the slides will be made available, and I'll post on our Facebook and Twitter sites the minute they are available for you guys to go in and have a look at. So thank you very much. If you guys think that this webinar was valuable and you want to hear more webinars in the future on any topic, on any discussion, we've got a lot of experts out there in a lot of different sports. We can bring them on. We can discuss nutrition. We can discuss training. And I think that they can be very valuable because it's got a very big reach. And they can be in the comfort of your own home as well without having to drive anywhere. So thank you very much, and we'll be in touch. Wishing you all a good Comrades, and come and say hello at the expo. It'd be great to meet you all. Thank you.